I think a lot of people have said over the years that Stu should write a book about his life, but it never happened.
For Linda to, you know, to try to do it on her own, and there's just so much stuff.
We were waltzing that night in Kentucky by that beautiful harvest moon. And I was the boy that was lucky, but it all ended too soon. As I sit here alone in the moonlight, I see your smiling face, and I long once more for your embrace and that beautiful Kentucky waltz.
Stu Turley grew up in the rural Kentucky town of Mount Sterling. Like many high achievers, his is a story of strong family values, perseverance, and believing in himself. Stu grew up during the most challenging years of the 20th century. First, the Great Depression, followed by World War II. By 1952, his senior year of high school, Stu had tragically lost both his parents. Now, please pardon the pun, but it's time to hear it right from the horse's mouth. You'll soon see what I mean.
And that beautiful Kentucky.
My childhood, of course, was in Kentucky, except that I was conceived in California. My dad was in the racehorse business, owned some horses, and was racing in California. My older brother and sister were there, of course, and my mother was expecting me when this was in 1934, and things were tough in the middle of the Depression. And my dad was going broke there, so he sold his enough horses to get train fare back to Kentucky. So that's how I got from California to Kentucky. And then I was born in Lexington.
My father was the sixth generation Turley in Montgomery County, Kentucky. It goes down from James to David to Willis to Joe C. to Albert to my father and to me, all of us in Montgomery County. Mother and her family came from Lee County, Kentucky, a small town called Bataville, sort of at the edge of the mountains, down to Lexington. And she finished high school in Lexington, and then she went to the University of Kentucky and got her degree in journalism. Claire, sometimes called Claire Maupin, she was 18 months younger than I, but of course, because of that difference in the age, we grew up together. She was there by the time I was old enough to know what was going on. And as I told you, we were in California some. We were closer probably because of the traveling that we did because of Daddy's racehorses. She was a beautiful girl. She had a lot of friends.
My father was a very different kind of a person. My father had been born on a farm. His family had been farmers for generations. My dad was a great outdoorsman, loved to hunt and fish, but hunting primarily. And I used to go hunting with him when I was a little kid, and all the way up until the time that he died. As I mentioned, he died in an automobile accident in December of my senior year in high school. But we had great times as a father and son. My brother, being 8 years older than me, and my sister 6 years older, had gone to college and had had moved away, and I spent a lot of time as the young member of the family with my mother and dad, and with my dad in particular in these fun kinds of things that that he liked to do. And he loved football too, and basketball, but I think he liked football best, and he would come to the games. My mom was a special person, and I assume most people feel like their mothers are, but mine really was. She was ahead of her time in some ways, starting from the fact that she graduated from the University of Kentucky. So she was a college graduate. She graduated in 1926, which is the year my older brother was born. And she later became quite an accomplished insurance salesperson. And she set some records. In fact, I'm proud of a couple of clippings that I have. She sold insurance for the Minnesota Mutual Life Insurance Company. And she set a record in a sales contest that they had by selling one new policy every day, 7 days a week for a month, 30 days. So in the 30 days, she sold 30 plus new policies. She had to sell at least one new policy each day. And that was a record that no one, male or female, had ever achieved in the Minnesota Mutual Life Insurance Company. And She was a wonderful mother and an unassuming person. Later, when she was in poor health and more declining health than we realized at the time, but she worked the last couple of years that she could work at the local newspaper office. I learned that you can be nice to people and still achieve things. She was a person who was beloved by everybody in town. She was a genuinely nice person to everyone that she met. And she was a mother that I'm proud of.
The untimely death of Mavis Sternberg Turley in 1950 was not only a family tragedy, but felt throughout Mount Sterling. The daily paper carried the news on its front page, and I quote, "Mrs. Turley was one of the most beloved women who ever lived in Mount Sterling. She was devoted to her family who idolized her, and the example she set for them and others could be followed by all of us."
Some of my early childhood memories center around a wonderful woman that that we had, and in those days we referred to her as a colored woman, and her name was Carrie, and Carrie helped raise me in the early days until probably the time I started school, and she was, you know, quite a wonderful woman. Carrie gave me a nickname, Toon, T-O-O-N, and that stuck with me all the way through high school, and still when I go back to Kentucky to visit, there are a few people that call me Toon, and that'll always be my name in Mount Sterling to a lot of people there. Well, when I was a kid, I was always involved in sports of one sort or the other. I was lucky that school came pretty easy for me. And And therefore, I didn't study as hard and as long as I should have. I made good grades. I was on the honor roll and in the National Honor Society and so forth. But if I'd worked harder, I probably could have, had better grades than I did. Got along fine with my teachers.
He was just good in everything. He was just made honor roll all the time.
Honor roll?
Oh, yeah, I never watched him. And didn't make but one C in all of high school. One semester, one C in high school.
I was secretary of the class.
But he was good. He was excellent student. Excellent person to deal with. Pleasant. Never any problems.
One of my early mentors was football coach. And his name was Tiny Jones. Tiny was about 5'8" and weighed about 350 pounds and tough as nails. He never could have coached in today's environment because he was hands-on, literally. He would slap you on the back, he would kick you in the butt, he would do whatever he thought it took to motivate you to do your best. Another mentor, or a pair of mentors that I had, were Junie and Betty Barnard. And they were a young married couple with two very small children who took care of me for almost a year after my father was killed. My mother had died earlier. My father was killed in an automobile accident early in December of my senior year in high school.
He was a real good student, and it came easy to him because he didn't study. And then I know when he lived with us, he did something I never could get my own children to do. If he went out at night and changed his plans that it was going to be later, he always called me. And for some reason, I never could convince my own children to do that.
I was the seventh generation in my family, born in Montgomery County, going back to, I believe, the 1790s or something like that. Quite a long period of time. And unfortunately, I suppose, my brother and I are the last of the Turleys that were born in Montgomery County. Mount Sterling had six or seven pool halls. There was one in particular that we used to go to called Jones Pool Room. And when I was a kid, probably early in high school, we would leave the high school at lunchtime, go down to the Jones Pool Room, and we had an hour for lunch, so we'd shoot pool. We'd get an RC Cola and a bag of peanuts and pour the peanuts into the RC Cola, and that would be our lunch while we played a few games of pool, and then we'd rush back to school and try not to be late. I always liked to dance, and we had dances in the gymnasium at the high school, Mount Sterling High School. And the girls were usually better dancers than the boys were, but I learned to dance, and Betty Barnard was one of my coaches informally that taught me dancing, and I've enjoyed it all my life. There were 50 in my graduating class, but I had some particularly close friends, guys that I hung out with. Pat Dale was one of my very close friends. Billy Bashford, who I mentioned earlier. A fellow by the name of Pete Kirk, Buddy Wheeler, and I could go on and on, naming more and more guys. But we had close friendships and meaningful friendships, things that we did that remain important things that we still talk about.
Tune. It was his nickname, T-O-O-N. Don't ask me where he got it. He had it from a little kid up.
And even if they would write a story about him, his basketball, or something about him in the paper, they would refer to him as Tune.
Stewart and I go back to the first grade. We went through 12 years of school together, played sports together. Stewart was always an exceptional student and athlete at Mount Sterling, and we always had a good time.
We go back. We used to travel the storm sewers and all the kids' stuff. I think we made our first fishing trip together. Both of us slipped away, and we go all the way through school and even out of school together. Been through the good times with him and the bad times. Some of the tragedies in his life I've been involved with, and he's a great person, great friend.
Mount Sterling High School's class of 1952 is indelibly etched into Stu Turley's memory. So let's reflect for a moment on this special year, not only in Mount Sterling, but around the globe. Retired General Dwight David Eisenhower becomes the 34th U.S. President. British Prime Minister Winston Churchill visits Capitol Hill. In Hollywood, big hats are in. I mean big hats. And Humphrey Bogart takes home the Best Actor Award at the Oscars. Here in Kentucky, 6 Trojan seniors are selected for the National Honor Society, including Stewart Turley. In Mount Sterling High's annual popularity contest, you guessed it, Stu is named most popular, most attractive, most ability, best dancer, and yes, most graceful. In the sports world, Eddie Arcaro rides Hill Gale to victory in the Kentucky Derby. Troy Ruttman takes the checkered flag at the Indy 500. The 1952 Summer Olympics are held in Helsinki, Finland. And Rocky Marciano is the heavyweight champ. In pro football, the Detroit Lions are number one. Our Trojan football team, captained by Stu, is pretty darn good too, winning 7 of 9 games, including a season-ending 2-0 shutout in the mud, snow, and wind. More about that in a minute. In basketball, LaSalle beats Dayton for the NCAA championship amidst a shocking point-shaving scandal. But it was no surprise as our Trojans basketball squad posted an impressive winning season behind MVP and captain Stewart Toon Turley. Stu made the Kentucky All-Star team as well as the East-West All-Star team. Stu was honored with several awards at the annual Mount Sterling Pep Club and Boosters Dinner. Congratulations to all 1952 Mount Sterling seniors.
The last game of my high school career, football game, was about the middle of November, and a cold wave was coming through Kentucky. It had been raining, then it turned cold, and the field froze, and then it started snowing. And it was between 10 and 15 degrees when we kicked off at about 8 o'clock that night, with a couple of inches of snow on a frozen field. And we didn't have all of the fancy equipment they have today. We wore some long johns under our football uniform, had some cotton work gloves, and went out and played. We had some old heaters on the sideline that we'd all try to cluster around during timeouts or something like that. But we didn't have many timeouts because everybody played both ways in those days, offense and defense. We played that game in those conditions, and we won the game 2-0 on a safety. Well, my dad, I think, had been sitting in the stands keeping warm with maybe a little bottle of bourbon, but he came down to the dressing room after the game and gave me $50 and the keys to our car and said, go have a good time. And so I was cruising around town in this old Buick Super that we had and wondering what we could do to have a good time. 3 of my buddies were in the car with me. And we decided, why not take a trip? So we said, that's great. And we pooled our money. Some of the other fellows had a few dollars. And we took off for New Orleans. We stayed in New Orleans a week. The motivation to go to New Orleans was because my high school girlfriend, who was a year ahead of me in school, Phyllis Lowry was her name, had gone to school in New Orleans at Sophie Newcomb, which was a girls' school part of Tulane University. And we thought that it'd be fun to visit her, and she fixed my friends up with dates, and we had a great time. We were pulling into a parking lot a night or two before we were leaving New Orleans, and at this party, and I can't remember exactly where it was, but it was it was quite a crowded parking lot. The car pulled in next to us, and we had a door open, and it just, the other car just kind of peeled that door back against the front of the car. So we had to get out, and with the four guys and so forth, we were able to push the door back and get it to latch. We took some wire that was in the trunk of the car and wired it together so it would stay. So while we were down there, I remember it was Tulane's homecoming football game. And it was against the University of Kentucky, and that's what motivated us to stay through that weekend. And then later on Sunday, we drove back home, and I was beginning to wonder, you know, what I was going to tell my dad, and showing up with a car that was damaged, you know, pretty seriously. And so I went in to face the music and told my dad we really had a good time, and I told him about the car. He went down and looked at the car, and he said, well, the next time I tell you to go out and have a good time, I'm going to be more specific. And that's all he said. That was the end of the story. In Kentucky, most of the garages had a basketball hoop over the door, and so we played a lot of basketball in the driveways and with hoops on the garage doors when we were little kids. And then I started playing organized basketball in junior high school, and played, you know, through the seventh, eighth, ninth grade, and then played varsity basketball. And we had a, you know, for a small town, we had a, you know, a good basketball team. We had a good athletic program in Mount Sterling. In the summers, I did anything I could to make a few bucks. The best job I had, part-time job, was lifeguarding. And I was a lifeguard for two summers at the recreation park swimming pool in Mount Sterling. And the I gave swimming lessons. First I had to get certified by the Red Cross, which I did as a lifeguard, and then as an instructor. And but I would give swimming lessons. I'd sit in the chair, and there were several of us that worked there. And but what a great job it was. I got paid, you know, to swim. I got paid to flirt with the girls who were out at the pool, and we'd take a break. There was a tennis court there. We'd go out and play a little tennis. So that was one of the jobs I remember the most and enjoyed the most. When my mom passed away, it was a shock, a surprise to all of us. And my grandmother, who was living with my uncle in Lexington, came over to live with my dad and I. And my dad traveled in his job. By that time, he was a civilian employee for the Army Signal Corps. My grandmother, wonderful, wonderful woman, but like a mother hen, she was hovering all the time, and I think she, you know, she drove both my dad and I a little bit batty. So we, you know, gracefully took her back to my uncle, and And we moved into the local hotel, the Montgomery Hotel in Mount Sterling.
Junie and Betty Barnard, who of course lived in Mount Sterling, came to me and asked if Stewart could come live with them for the rest of his year rather than coming to Lexington to live with me. They said he's a senior, he's on the basketball team, we'll take good care of him, and he can stay with us instead of moving to Lexington and having to give up his friends in the final year of his final high school year.
This accident was the middle of December, and just at the beginning of basketball season, and after my dad's funeral, and I got straightened away, I was immediately back with the team playing basketball. And you know, that keeps your mind occupied and keeps you physically occupied. You've got a good support system in that regard. And it was my senior year in high school. So it was an important period, you know, to me. And it was an important period for a number of reasons, because I was fortunate enough to be able to get a basketball scholarship and go to college on a basketball scholarship. And I'm not sure that I would have been able to go to college. I would have found a way, but I'm not sure I would have been able to go to college in the same way if I hadn't been able to play basketball. So there was a good payback from that.
Stu will be the first to tell you that growing up in a small town was not only a blessing, it shaped his future.
And you know, when I left and went to college, the first college that I went to on a basketball scholarship was a liberal arts school in Florida, Rollins College. And it was a small college that I felt that same sense of community. And I've always felt fondly of small liberal arts schools, and later became involved with Eckerd College, which I feel also fit that bill nicely. When I left Rollins, I went to the University of Kentucky, which isn't a huge university as you think of it, but it was huge to me in those days. In Lexington, I think University of Kentucky at that time had 8,000 or 10,000 students. You know, my brother, my older brother, who I always looked up to and who's a great guy, still is a great guy, he was a KA, Kappa Alpha Order, at the University of Kentucky. And I can remember going over to the fraternity house when I was a young kid, and he would take me over, and I thought, boy, this is really big stuff. Well, when I went away to college, I was a KA legacy, and Rollins College had a KA chapter, and I was pledged, and I was president of the pledge class. Then I was initiated into the fraternity. I think that occurs usually around Christmas time, somewhere in that period. And then later that spring, even in my freshman year, I was elected president of the fraternity. Being on my own, I kind of felt like I was more mature than I really was. I got married at 19 after my freshman year in college to a girl by the name of Judy Hall, who I met at Rollins, and we went up to the University of Kentucky, which we thought would be the best thing to do at that point in time. And I had an invitation from Adolf Rupp to play basketball at the University of Kentucky, and I knew that was a tough environment. And as a freshman at Rollins, I was a starter and enjoyed it and got a lot of good experience. Kentucky had been suspended from NCAA play for a year, the year I got out of high school, which was one reason I didn't go immediately there. And I thought, boy, I can get this experience. I can play at the college level, even a small college. And then when I go back to UK, if I do, I'll be ahead. Well, the opposite was true. The kids that had stayed there and had worked all year, even though they hadn't been playing intercollegiate games, they had been learning and drilling and so forth. And I was kind of far behind them. So I saw early on in the fall of that year at Kentucky that I was going to be so far at the end of the bench that they'd forget my name, and I dropped off the team. And by early December, 1st of December probably. And as I say, I was married. Adolph Rupp didn't like that. The Kentucky Derby was a special occasion, a special deal. Of course, it wasn't in Lexington. It was at Churchill Downs in Louisville. But all you had to do was, once you were signed up with them and so forth, you called in on Thursday, and then you showed up for work on Saturday. But they paid you for 3 days, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, at $20 a day. Now, in 1954 or 55, whatever that was big money, $60 for 1 day's work. I showed up for work that day at the Derby, and the guy from Keeneland was an assistant manager in the Parimutuels, and he came up to me and he said, "Stu, have you ever cashed tickets?" And I said, "No, I've never cashed. I've only sold tickets." It's quite a bit of difference between the selling and cashing. He said, "Well, today you're going to cash." He said, "You're a smart young guy and you can learn fast, and we're short of cashiers." So I cashed $2 win tickets from the end of the first race that day until an hour after the end of the last race. I never saw the end of the line at my window. It was constant. And you're responsible for every dime that goes through your window. And you sign a form that if you come up short, it's made up out of your pay, or you're obligated for it. And it becomes tedious, and you really pay attention to what you're doing. I didn't come up short that day. You know, the decade of the 50s was a very important and active and memorable decade in my life. The 50s were bittersweet in a lot of ways, but in 1950, my mother passed away. In 1951, my father passed away. 1952, I graduated, went away to school. 1953, I got married. 1954, I had my first child. 1955, that first child died at age 20 months. 1955, I went to work for Crown Cork and Seal Company, which was an important point in my career. 1957, my daughter Carol was born. 1959, my second daughter Karen was born. So a lot of stuff happened in the 50s. I dropped out of college after having the child and toward the end of my second year in college. And I had to decide what I was going to do. So Judy, my first wife, and I moved to Florida from Kentucky. We'd both decided that we liked Florida, and that after college we wanted to live in Florida. We didn't want to work somewhere else and then retire to Florida. We wanted to start off there. I had a job at a company called Florida Fashions. Florida Fashions was a mail order merchandising firm in Orlando. And they sold products to mostly farm girls and small town girls in the South and the Midwest who dreamed of coming to Florida and couldn't afford it, but they could buy a dress for $5.99 from the cover, back cover of a movie magazine. I also learned that the best jobs didn't go to people like me. They went to members of the family. It was a family-owned and operated business. But anyway, I supervised the index department, and I left there and went to work for Crown Cork and Seal Company. Crown Cork and Seal was company based in Philadelphia, but with a plant in Orlando, Florida, that made tin cans for the citrus industry. It was a good company. I learned a lot. I had a very fast path of advancement at Crown. It was an experience that was important to me throughout my entire career. After being the general night shift foreman, I became the plant superintendent, and then eventually became the plant manager of that plant in Orlando when I was still in my 20s.
The earliest memories of my dad were probably in Winter Park before we moved to Philadelphia. And I just remember a lot of boats and parties. They had a big group of friends that they all went to college with. And, you know, we would go water skiing and go to barbecues. And he was a lot of fun. He loved to dance. He loved to goof around. And that was probably the earliest memories.
It was so much fun. First of all, they were young and their friends were young, and we were always going to the beach to New Smyrna. We were just looking at some home videos of New Smyrna Beach, and it's probably, you know, 1963, 1964. You know, we were there during spring break sometimes. The cars are driving up and down the sand, and everybody's doing the twist, and it was just fun, fun, fun. Played a lot of ping pong, which I just bought a ping pong table. I'm continuing the tradition. And we water skied. It was just, you know, beach, sunshine, Florida, the 60s. It was fabulous.
They were young parents, so they had a lot of fun. They had a lot of friends, so they were very social. And their friends had kids, and all the kids would get together and play, and we would, they're still friends to this day.
Well, we just had a whole bunch of wonderful people. We enjoyed ourselves very much. We would go out on the lake. I had a boat, a ski boat, not one of the fancy ones, just an outboard and so on. I recall one time, we in the afternoons would take all the children and we'd swim and have Kentucky Fried Chicken, or in cases they have, all the ladies or the families would bring food. As I pulled up, they knew I was coming, and Ernie was in my boat, stealing my boat, and Stu's standing on land, and the word was hit it. He was jump starting on a slalom ski, and they were laughing so hard because I'd been trying to do it forever, and Stu was he got so. He was laughing so much, he jump started, came around, and he just fell off the skis down like into a cypress knee. but they really put wood over on me.
In 1964, when I was manager of the two plants in Florida, I got a call from my boss in Philadelphia, and he was coming down to see me, and he came down and told me they wanted me to come to Philadelphia and run the Philadelphia plant. I was there 2 years, and when I left, it was the most profitable plant in the company. Instead of four unions, we then had three unions. We'd gone through a strike. We'd gone through some interesting and tough periods, as well as I was able to get the three principal unions to work together in a manner in which we could make the plant successful. Because I told him if we didn't make it successful, it was going to end up being closed down and nobody would have a job. A couple of mentors in my period with Crown, Cork, and Seal. The first one was back in Orlando, a fellow by the name of Bob Woolley. Bob had something that he believed and he taught me, and it stuck with me my entire career. Bob Woolley told me, he said, Stu, he said, the way you climb the ladder of success is by pushing the guy in front of you on that ladder and pulling the guy behind you on the ladder so that you all move up together. And I thought, you know, what a simple analogy this is, but how true it is. And I've used that a number of occasions throughout my career to explain to young managers how they can succeed, but they can only succeed by cooperating with and working and pushing the guy in front of them and making sure they pull somebody behind them that can take their place too. Also, I had another great mentor at Crown, a fellow by the name of Ed Stewart. Ed remained a friend of mine the rest of my life until he passed away about 2 years ago at age 90-something. And I decided that I just didn't want to spend the rest of my life in Philadelphia. I liked it. We enjoyed living there for the 2 years we were there. We took advantage of the opportunities available to us in that part of the world and traveled to New York and to the World's Fair, which was going on at that point in time. But I just didn't want to spend the rest of my life in Philadelphia.
Well, I was 5 to 7 when we lived there, so I don't really remember a whole lot. But I do remember like sledding and living in the snow, and most of my memories I think might come from home movies that I've watched, but it was fun. It was good. But I was happy to move back to Florida, even though I had to leave my best friend Lynn Brooks.
I just remember being cold and strange, but it was a nice change. I mean, I think it was good for us to just have a perspective so that when we did come back to Florida, we were all like, woohoo. I mean, everybody was really happy to be back.
And so I decided to make a couple of calls at that point in time. I had enjoyed the time I spent in the clothing store. I enjoyed the mail order merchandising business. That was different, but it was still close to the consumer. And so he said, well, he got my phone number and so forth, and I was going from Sarasota to Winter Park, where we were going to spend a few days. I got a phone call the next morning. He said, can you drive over to Clearwater and meet Jack Eckerd? And I said, sure. So the next day I drove to Clearwater and met Jack, and that started the relationship that we developed and resulted in him offering me a job later.
I found my thrill.